Well, good afternoon. Welcome back to week four of our sermon series, What If Jesus Judged? Actually, before I jump in today, I have one serious apology I need to make to you today. Last week I preached, and I got an email the day after I preached where someone pointed out to me correctly that I had taught something that was not true from this stage. It wasn't a huge, egregious thing. I was teaching on the seven churches of Revelation. I'd said there was only one of the churches that Jesus had nothing critical to say about. And someone pointed out, well, what about this other one? And I thought, well, that's wrong. I studied this. And then I read it, and it turns out the emailer was right. Actually, two churches that Jesus had nothing critical to say. So that might seem like a small thing, but when I stand up here and open that book and speak to you, it's really, really important to me to be accurate, and I wasn't in that case. So I want to ask for your forgiveness and make an apology today. A few years ago at my last church, one of the middle school boys invited one of his friends to come to the Bible class on a Wednesday night, which is awesome. His friend's name was D'Angelo, and I kind of picked up that D'Angelo wasn't an every Sunday church kind of kid, didn't know a ton about the Bible, so it was amazing to have him there as we opened up the scriptures. But there was a little bit of a problem that day, because the day that D'Angelo came wasn't the class when we were teaching about the basics of Christianity, or the forgiveness of Jesus, or what happened on Easter morning. No, the day that D'Angelo came for the very first time was the class where we were talking about sex. Of course. So I'm teaching, the basics of the biblical sexual ethic, and I'm just thinking in the back of my head the whole time, I wonder what this kid is thinking. As I'm going through the passages and the verses and the do's and the don'ts, what God wants us to do, what Jesus did for us, I'm thinking in the back of my head, what is it like to know almost nothing about the Bible and to hear this as a 14-year-old boy? And what do you know, just before the class ended, whose hand slowly went up with a question? D'Angelo. I'm going to tell you what he said before I say amen. I was thinking about that day, though, that sometimes when we talk about sex in our homes or in a Bible class or in church, it can be uncomfortable, it can be awkward for 17 different reasons. But do you know the reason why we keep doing that here at this place? Because God started it. We try our best to be a Bible-teaching church, and if you would actually read the Bible cover to cover, you would find out that in the Old Testament and the New, our perfect Father in heaven was not shy, and he was not sheepish about the topic of sex. The prophets weren't, the apostles weren't, the Father wasn't, the Spirit wasn't, Jesus in his own ministry wasn't, and so we feel it's important just to be honest, to be candid, and to be biblical. In fact, in this sermon series, as we study these letters that Jesus wrote in Revelation 2 and 3, did you know that there is one topic that comes up in the first letter, and the third letter, and the fourth letter? The only topic repeated by Jesus that many times, and the topic is? Yeah, you guessed it. The truth is, though, even if Jesus didn't talk about it that much, as a pastor of this church, I would still feel compelled to talk about it often. Because the longer the years go by and the more I get to know you, the more you communicate with me there online or on TV and you send in your letters from your homes, from your prison cell, I realize that sex is something as awkward as it can be that intersects with all of our lives. I recently read from author Peggy Orenstein that the average American teenager is exposed to 14,000 sexualized messages a year. 14,000. And yet, in her very same research, she did in-depth interviews with 70 young women and asked them, among the many questions, how many of you ever had a real conversation about sex with your own father? Out of the 70 young women who are absorbing 14,000 messages about sex each year, how many out of 70 ever talked with their own dad? Two. In research, Ornstein also found that at that time, 92% of the top songs on the Billboard charts mentioned or were focused on sex. This was before a 2020 survey came out that said 1 in 6 young adults in America between the ages of 18 and 24 now identifies as LGBTQ. And just in case you didn't know, pornography is still a thing. It's out there. And I don't have to tell most of you, it's not just out there. It's in here. As a praise-singing, Bible-reading, Jesus-adoring church family, you and I talk about this behind closed doors a lot, don't we? You're struggling with pornography, and you don't know how to escape it, and you need help. You're questioning your sexual identity, orientation, you need guidance and shepherding, you want to know what God really wants you to do, and you send me the email. Your marriage is struggling. Maybe it's gotten to the point of an affair, or maybe you can just see it drifting in that direction, and you want to do things God's way. Or maybe, you know, you just realize that you're 7 years into marriage, 12 years into marriage, 1 year into marriage, 50 years into marriage, and this idea of just a healthy, beautiful, exciting, open, creative, communicative, what you like, what you don't like, what she likes, what she doesn't like. You've never actually had the kind of sexual experience that God always intended when he created it. So for a whole bunch of reasons, not just the stats and the culture and the world, but for our sake, to enjoy God's gifts, to not have to deal with the baggage and consequence of sin, today we're going to talk about sex. And if that makes you uncomfortable, my defense today is Jesus started it. Today we're going to look at a letter that he wrote to a first century church in the city of Pergamum. And once again, Jesus brings up the topic, and we're going to see what Jesus said to that church, and we're going to consider what he might say to our church today. So we're going to be in Revelation chapter 2. Today, if you want to follow along on the screen or open your own Bibles, here's where we begin with Jesus' words in verse 12. It says, "To the angel of the church in Pergamum write, these are the words of him who has the sharp, double-edged sword." Last week I mentioned the angel of the church is probably a fancy way of saying the local pastor of the church. And Jesus wants this pastor to know that the one who is speaking, Jesus, is the one who has the sharp, double-edged sword. Help me out for a second. Do you think the fact that Jesus has a sharp, double-edged sword is good news for you or bad news for you? Everyone gets the vote. Go. Some good, some bad, some both. You're in the middle. And you're right. It's like, if Jesus is coming at you with a sharp, double-edged sword, it's going to go rough for you. He's going to cut to the heart with the words that come out of his mouth. But if Jesus is defending you, if your life when it comes to sexuality is in a good spot, he can fight off guilt and sin and shame, the people who judge you, people who exclude you, people who come after you, the devil who wants to accuse you. Like, he will defend you not with some dull knife that he found in the trunk, but a sharpened double-edged sword. That's what the words of Jesus always do. They attack and they defend. And here's what Jesus says, verse 13. He says to the pastor, I know where you live, where Satan has his throne, yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city, where Satan lives. Sounds like a lovely place to move, doesn't it? Where Satan lives. Pergamum was a really big city in the ancient world. It's in western Turkey on a modern map. It was big, huge, kind of temples to Rome and all things Roman. In fact, it's really amazing. You should Google this after church. In a Berlin museum, they have found what is called the altar of the Temple of Zeus. This massive pagan, the staircase leading up to it is about as wide as this stage, and the altar itself wider than this church. It's stored in a museum right now in Berlin. Like, these people loved Zeus, they loved their gods, they loved Caesar, they loved Rome, and that's probably the reason why this guy named Antipas was not loved. It's probably why he was murdered for his faith. Some early church tradition says that Antipas would not bow the knee and worship the gods of Rome, so as a consequence, they boiled him alive in a bronze kettle. Can you imagine? And yet the pastor of the church saw it, and yet he did not let go of Jesus. You catch those words? He says, I know where you live, and yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas. Like, this pastor might be next. He might be threatened, he might be tortured, he might be boiled alive, he might be crucified, he might be thrown to the beast, and yet he refused to compromise his faith. Now, write this down. Here's the good thing that Jesus has to say to this pastor and his church. The good was the pastor's personal courage. You could threaten him, you could accuse him, you could drag him to court. He wasn't letting go of Jesus. He was personally courageous. Now, kind of think of it like this, this giant Lego. Let's imagine this giant red Lego is Jesus, which is why I wrote Jesus on it. All right. This pastor, he thought of Jesus in such a big and beautiful and glorious way that he was going to hold on to Jesus no matter what anyone said or did. Like, a slap on the wrist, he's not going to let go of Jesus. A lash across the back, he's not letting go of Jesus. You could tie him to a stake, set him on fire, just tell him all he has to do is drop Jesus. He's not letting go of Jesus. What he had found in the Son of God was so beautiful and glorious that nothing in this life was worth letting him go. And to be honest with you, this is the point of you coming to church. Like, music is amazing. I love the musicians at our church. But the point isn't just to clap our hands, enjoy good coffee, and make some friends. Right? What I hope you get out of every single Sunday, every single time you're watching at home, is that Jesus becomes so beautiful to you that you learn to hold on to him and refuse to let him go. Like, devil can tempt you? Uh-uh. People can threaten you? Mm-mm. It can be difficult to obey, but still. A friend says she's disappointed. A boyfriend says he's going to break up with you. I want you to think so much of Jesus that no matter what happens, you remain courageous, personally courageous to his name. You start to think things like, well, who else has ever loved me like Jesus? Like, when I was a total mess, there was Jesus. When I went through my divorce and was just off the rails morally, there was Jesus. When I wandered and strayed from church, from the Bible, from prayer, from my values, there was Jesus. Y'all have forgiven me 1, 2, maybe 3 times. Jesus has forgiven me 7 billion times. When I was the most broken, there was Jesus. When I couldn't even forgive myself, there was Jesus. When I felt no value or worth, there was Jesus. When I went back to my old sin, there was Jesus every single day. He has never left me, never forsaken me. He has loved me. He has forgiven me. So you can do what you want to me. I'm holding on to Jesus. And that is my prayer, that you pay so much attention to the words of this book, to the lyrics of these songs, to the prayers that we pray, that in the end, you don't just leave with the melodies in your head, you leave with this kind of Jesus in your heart. That was the good. But it wasn't all good for the pastor at Pergamum. Jesus was proud of his personal courage, but There was something else happening in that church. And apparently the pastor knew about it, and yet the pastor put up with it. Want to guess what was happening? Let me read it to you. Verse 14. Nevertheless, Jesus continues, I have a few things against you. There are some among you who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin so that they ate food sacrificed to idols and committed sexual immorality. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teachings of the Nicolaitans. Repent, therefore. Otherwise, I will soon come to you and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Right, Jesus ain't playing. He's mad. And he says if they don't repent, that means if they don't change their mind about this, he is coming not to save them, but to go to war against them. I will fight against them, he says, with the sword of my mouth. Now, did you catch what made Jesus so mad? It's fascinating. It wasn't what the pastor did, and it wasn't what the pastor believed. It's what the pastor permitted. What Jesus says in these words is so anti-American. You might have missed it when I said it. He said, Pastor, I hold this against you, that there are some people among you who hold to the teaching of those people. If you've always thought that your personal beliefs are none of the pastor's business, you don't agree with Jesus. If you think church is about giving an offering and then the pastor can give you counseling when you need it, but otherwise you're going to do you, you don't agree with Jesus. Apparently Jesus says that I am not just supposed to get a salary and a little bit of authority here, but I have a deep responsibility to make sure that you hold to the teaching of Jesus. You catch that? He said it twice. Some people among you hold to the teaching of Balaam. Some of you hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans, and Pastor, that ain't okay with me, Jesus says. So, what is he talking about? It's a little bit deep, super contextual. So if you're new to church, the Bible, you've got to turn up your brain power for about 3 minutes, okay? With me? Balaam was a guy who lived about 1,500 years before Jesus wrote this letter. You can read all about him early in the Bible in the book of Numbers. He was essentially a prophet for hire that you could pay, and Balaam would come, and he would either bless you or he would curse them. And that's exactly what an ancient king named Balak wanted to happen. In the days of Moses, the people of Israel were marching towards Balak and his kingdom, and he freaked. He needed these people to be cursed before they took over his land. So Balak pays Balaam and has him come to curse the people of Israel, but Balaam won't. He says that God won't let him pronounce this curse. In fact, he just blesses Moses and the people of Israel. Then he does it again. Then he does it a third time. Then he does it a fourth time. And he's not going to get paid. And he's about to leave until he leans over to Balak and he says, sex. And in Numbers 24, Balaam takes off back to his hometown. And Balak knows the perfect way to get to Moses' people. Sex. They seduce the Israelites. They invite them to worship their fertility gods. They sacrifice animals. They have a big feast. And then they throw off the rails and the boundaries and the Ten Commandments, and they indulge in the sins of the flesh. And apparently in Pergamum, the same thing was happening. People were breaking the commandments. They weren't doing what the God of Israel had said. The pastor knew about it, but he smiled and he prayed for the people, and he didn't say a word. And the Nicolaitans were much the same. As best as scholars can suggest, there seemed to be this guy named Nicholas in the first century who gathered enough of a following that they called his people the Nicolaitans. And Nicholas said that you could have your sex and have your Savior too. Like, if Jesus forgives, then he'll forgive it, right? And if his love is unconditional, then you don't have to worry about any of that, right? And if he saves us from everything, then you're saved, right? So yeah, you're fine. You're going to heaven. You got Jesus, so just do whatever. He'll take care of it. And there were some people who didn't just struggle with that. In the text, it says they held to that teaching. That's what they believed too. And the pastor preached, and he prayed, and he permitted, and Jesus judged him. Now, write this down. The bad that Jesus saw in the church of Pergamum is what I'll call relational cowardice. The pastor himself had personal courage, but not when it came to the church. All right. So, what do you think Jesus would say to me, or to pastoral staff at our church? What would he say about us today? Would he repeat the same praise and the same critique? Are we better? Are we worse? Let's dig into that for a few minutes together. Let me start with just the basic definition of biblical sexual morality. I'd love for you to fill in this blank for me. Sex in the Bible, let me condense all the teaching on it. Sex is essentially this: God's gift to husband and wife. I don't have 100 passages to prove it, but I could. Sex is God's gift to husband and wife, and I mean every single word of that. Sex is God's gift. If you don't think sex is an inherently good thing, if you're like sheepish and awkward and embarrassed, you ain't biblical. The very beginning of sex happens before sin was even a thing. But before there was sin in Genesis 3, there was sex in Genesis 1 and 2. Adam and his wife Eve were naked, the Bible says, and they were unashamed. The Bible talks frequently about the joy of sex and the pleasure of sex. I dare you to read Proverbs 5 after church is done in the car and see if the kids in the back don't giggle just a little bit. There's a celebration of our bodies, the creator who made them, the one who designed nerve endings and pleasure and the ecstasy that sex can be when it is done well. The very start of the definition of the Bible is not a don't or you shall not. It's a good father who wraps up this incredible wedding gift and gives it to every husband and every wife. It's God's gift. And it's a gift for just two. Right? It's not God's gift to a husband and his wives, polygamy. It's not a gift to husbands and wives in polyamory. It's not a gift to a man or a woman and their digital partners through pornography. It's meant to be the two becoming one flesh. And it's husband, not boyfriend, not friend with benefits, not we're engaged and God already knows our hearts. God said it's only after a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife that the two become one flesh. And as you may have seen, it's not a husband and his partner or significant other. It's husband and his wife. One man, one woman, in the covenant called marriage. That's good sex, according to God. Now, if that definition leaves you with a whole bunch of questions, I get it. Actually, I hesitated as I was writing this sermon because I hate I really hate covering deep topics in a shallow way that leaves you with more questions than answers. I wish I had enough minutes, probably enough hours to go over all of this today, but here's a deal I want to make with you. If you've never really learned about biblical sexuality in an in-depth way, I have some free books for you to grab before you leave church today. There's a little booklet called Sexpectations. It's four sermons that we preached here at our church on the topic, and another booklet called Gay and God, which dives into sexual orientation, sexual identity. You know, what happens if you have these desires? What does God and His Word say about that? Both those books are free. You can grab them. If you're watching online, you can go to timeofgrace.org, jump to the store, search the website. There's so much teaching there. And if this is new to you or confusing to you, or you have a bunch of just honest, humble questions, I would love to answer them then. Now, if questions are not what you have, but instead regrets are what you have, we get that too. It's pretty easy to fill in the blank. Sex is God's gift to a husband and a wife, but let's be real. We as a church family get that God's word can be really difficult. We're not promoting this as our official teaching because we do it perfectly well or even average. We're promoting this because this is what our perfect Father in heaven has revealed to us. And if hearing this simple definition just makes you think about all those moments, those thoughts, those words, those choices, those nights, those mornings, those years, those seasons, we get it. Really, we do. I was a virgin until my wedding night. Kind of. Many of you know that a long, long struggle with pornography was part of my story, even though I was a church-going, dinner table praying, ministry studying kind of kid. It's hard to wait. And honestly, if it wasn't for Kim's self-control and her spiritual strength, her good boundaries, I probably couldn't say that I would have made it to the finish line. I get it. And most of our church family does too. And for a whole bunch of reasons, this is one of the hardest things in the Bible to obey. Like, I come to church every Sunday, I give an offering, I get up 5 minutes early, but to be self-controlled, to embrace everything that this is so, so difficult. For some of you, the difficult part of this teaching is believing that it's God's gift. Right. Maybe you grew up in one of those homes where your parents were cowards. They were so scared about the talk that they left you defenseless and ignorant in a world where Satan was so ready to peddle his lies and half-truths about your body. Or maybe you grew up in one of those churches where sex was talked about, but just don't wait. And then you got married. And to enjoy it, to communicate about it, to talk about desires and like, there's no space for that in your brain because you were never given that kind of model. To see it as a gift. You might be married right now, and you might be the higher desire partner or the lower desire partner to see. Like, this is God's idea. This is a good thing. It takes work. It takes practice. But just like we want to grow in faith, in communication, in our love for each other, we also want to grow in our sexual intimacy. For some of you, that's very, very, very hard. There are countless sexless marriages within the Christian church, and it breaks the heart of the Creator who created our bodies. It's hard. For some of you, what's hard is the waiting. Right? You're dating. You're into him. He's into you. You want him. He wants you. Like, you're ready. You're committed. This isn't some dangerous fling. Like, it is hard to trust God and say, nope, not yet. Not yet. Not yet. To believe that God knows what he's doing when he says, no, only after the covenant has been made, I'll give you the gift, but not until then. No shortcuts, no asterisks, no excuses, no exceptions. That's hard. For some of us, it's Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, Netflix. Like, to not mentally be unfaithful, to not give in to the latest show because it has a good plot, to change the channel to, like Job said, to have a covenant with your own eyes. That's hard. And for some of you, a lot of you at our church, what's hard is the man and woman part. Well, you're a guy who's attracted to guys. You didn't choose it, but that's you. You're a young woman who's always been drawn to men and women. And you know, and for some of you to think that God would want you to remain celibate. That you could watch all your heterosexual friends like fall in love and date and have the belly bumps and the little kids and the onesies and the outfits and the grandchildren. And maybe for you, you'll never have that. The thought that is the right thing to do, the godly thing to do. Like, that is so crazy hard, right? So I want you to know, if when we talk about sex, you think, like, I'm here, God. We get it. Right? That is us as a church family. And if you bring some regrets into church today, look to the right and look to the left, because one of the two people next to you does too, and probably both. That makes me think of the story of the pastor in the dumpster. Have I told you this one? True story. There's once a pastor who was struggling with pornography. Every time his wife was away from their apartment, he would pull out these magazines that he had hidden. He would indulge his sinful nature, and he always hated it. He knew it was wrong, but he couldn't let it go. And so one day, he said, enough's enough. I'm done with this. I hate this. I want to do what God wants. So he packed up all of his magazines. He went down the stairs of the apartment, and there's this big dumpster, you know, with the real high edges. And he takes the bag, and he throws it in, and he leaves the porn behind for a few minutes. And then something within him is like pulled back to it. And he's not ready to let go of his sin just yet. So he jumps up, pulls himself up to get over the edge of the dumpster to get his porn, except he slips. And he falls head first into the dumpster, puts his arm down to catch himself. True story. Breaks his arm. Which now means he can't pull himself out of the dumpster. Which means he has to call his wife to tell her to pick up the pastor with the broken arm and the broken soul sitting in a puddle full of his own porn. I like that story. Because the details might be different, but that's us. That's the couple that has the talk and says, no, we're going to wait. And then they're drawn back to it. It's the woman who says, I shouldn't be looking at these websites. I'm done. God help me. This is the last time. And she's pulled back to it. It's the person who feels same-sex attraction and they indulge it, even though they know what God wants. If that feels like your story, this might be the most important thing I'm going to say all day. We worship a Savior who is a dumpster diver. The Jesus that I know and love is the kind of God who dives into situations like that to save his broken people. If you have some conception of God that he is high and holy and keeping his hands clean from the messiness of our sexual lives, that is not the God of the Bible. Jesus threw himself into a kind of world where he was known as the friend of sinners, drunkards, and yes, prostitutes. He saved those who have been caught up in adultery, and the gospel was preached in the Greek and Roman world where everyone was off the rails when it came to the self-control of their own body. We have a Savior who forgives you, who cleanses you, who redeems you, who bandages your broken arm. He helps you out of the pit, and he promises to be with you every step of the way. So brothers and sisters, if you struggle with God's definition of sex, know this. Jesus is here. He is here as you struggle, as you try to make the best decision one day at a time, as you resist temptation and repent when you fall into it. He is right here. And if that's you, you are not the person that Jesus is speaking to in this text. I just gave you a very, very long tangent if some of you were paying attention. Because I know what the topic of sex does in the human heart. But now I need to speak very briefly to those of you who don't struggle with God's definition. You hold to something besides God's definition. Like, here's Jesus and all of his love and all of his truth. Are there any of you here today who have let go of Jesus to hold on to something else? To a belief that sex is not God's gift? That marriage is not required? That you should follow the desires of your heart no matter what the book says? Are there any of you here today who are ashamed to say out there what Jesus says in here? Ashamed to say it to your friends, your kids, your culture, yourself? If that's you, I am begging you today, repent. If Jesus comes back and he finds you not struggling, but smiling while you're sinning, he will go to war against you. On the last day, if you stand before Jesus and call him ignorant, if you claim that his definition of right and wrong is wrong, it will not go well with you. Out of his mouth will come a sharpened, double-edged sword, and his truth will cut you to the soul, and you will not make it. I'm begging you today, if you are living a sexually immoral lifestyle, if you are holding to it instead of struggling against it before it is too late, repent. 80 years of love in this life is nothing compared to forever, so repent. Saving money on rent to sleep in the same bed where you know what is happening is not worth it. Repent. If after the service is done, you have to pick up the phone, you have to send a text, you have to restate your beliefs on social media, whatever it costs you, be as courageous as the pastor from Pergamum. Hold to him. Do not renounce the name of Jesus. You will not regret it when he comes. Because friends, he is coming. And that's why Jesus leaves us with these words today. He says in verse 17, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give that person a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to the one who receives it. That's a lot of symbolism there, but this is beautiful. Manna in the Old Testament was this miraculous bread that saved the people of Israel, fed them physically. The hidden manna seems to be this miraculous promise that Jesus gives to feed and strengthen our souls. If you're thinking right now, I don't know if I can do that. Jesus says, I will strengthen you. If you say, I feel so much shame, I can't tell anyone about the things that I've done. Jesus says, I will forgive you and I will give them love to love you. If you think you can't, Jesus will give you hidden manna that says you can. And not just that, he will give you a white stone. Back in the first century, in ancient courtrooms, if you were guilty, the jury would pass a black stone onto the bench. If you were not guilty, a white one. Jesus is saying here, if you overcome, if you repent, if you trust in me, I will declare you not guilty. I will spare you. I will save you. I will invite you into the feast in the kingdom of heaven. You will not regret following me, Jesus says. And I will write a new name on it. I wish I knew what the name was. Jesus says, we're only going to know it when we receive it. I don't know what name Jesus will call you on that day, but I know the names he calls us now. Loved, his own, redeemed, saved. He calls me son. He calls you daughter. He calls us his children. I don't know what name he will speak or what name he will write on that stone, but I know the expression on his face when he gives it to us. His face will be shining on us, communicating grace to us, and that will forever, ever give us peace. So, sex. It's never been easy. Not in the days of Moses, not in the days of Revelation, not in the days of modern America. It's not easy, but it's good. And there's a good God who will help us through it. Remember D'Angelo? 14-year-old raises his hand after I give this lesson. I'm thinking, oh no. D'Angelo, brand new, he listens to all the restrictions, the boundaries I've given. One man, one woman, wait until marriage to a 14-year-old kid. You know what he says to me? Pastor Mike, if everyone did that, this world would be a better place. And that I said, amen. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, you know. You know where we've been. You know what we've done. You know the things that we haven't done, but should have. Thank you for your unconditional love. Jesus, you spoke some hard words today, but the only reason you spoke them was to save us from something harder. Thank you for the love, even within your discipline and your rebuke. God, I know in our culture, the devil has convinced us that sexuality is everything. But to not indulge a desire would be to give up our very selves, but that's not true, because you are our life. You are our everything. You are the one thing that is needful. And so I pray right now, Jesus, that you would give your Holy Spirit, that we would believe that, that you are worth it, that you are worthy, that there is no one, there's nothing in this life that can bless us like you have blessed us with your forgiveness, with your patience, and with the free gift of eternal life. God, I pray for me, for all of our pastors right now, for courage. It's easier just to know something and let it pass, to not say something and just assume it will fix itself. Give us courage. Help us to be faithful to you, not ashamed of you. Help us not to fear the reaction of people, but instead to live in the fear of God, the fear of you. And finally, Heavenly Father, I pray that you would not let a single repentant person leave today with shame. I know right here in this space are people who have been unfaithful, people who have been adulterous, people who have prostituted their bodies, people who have been trafficked. There are people who struggle with sexual purity, people who struggle with patience. Jesus, when you went to the cross, you died for all of it, for the things that we've done and the things that have been done to us. And so may we leave today truly believing the words that we are soon about to hear, that your face is shining upon us, that you are looking on us with grace. And may that thought rid us of all shame and instead give us peace. I pray all this, God, because you love us, because you're listening to us, and because you long to help us. So we pray all these things today in Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen.